All right, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are. My name is Eric DeAndrea, and I'm a developer advocate here at Red Hat. And today I'm here to talk to you about Quarkus and its new continuous testing feature that was added in the recent Quarkus 2.0 release back at the end of June, early July 2021. The continuous testing feature allows developers to really get into a test-driven development mindset where Quarkus understands how the code that you write and how the tests that code interact with each other. So as you make changes to your source code, the tests can be automatically rerun, therefore speeding up your development cycle a little bit. So let's take a little look at how this works. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a new project. And I'm going to use IntelliJ, but this works just in any IDE or no IDE at all if you're just going from code.quarkus.io. I'm going to create a new project, and I'm going to use the RestEasy, the Reactive Jackson extension, just because that's what I always pick. And when I generate my project, what I'm going to end up with is the source code loaded in my IDE, and it generated some example code for me. It generated a endpoint and a test. And so what I always do when I use Quarkus and when I develop my applications with Quarkus is start Quarkus Dev, the continuous platform where it will automatically recompile and redeploy your code, but it'll also now continuously run your tests as you modify your source code. And so you see when it comes up here, I can resume testing. And what this will do is it'll run my entire test suite the first time. And then as I incrementally change my code, it'll incrementally run some tests. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to create another test for another endpoint that doesn't yet exist. And as soon as I save that, you can see it's picking it up. It ran one of two tests, but it failed because it tried to make an HTTP request to an endpoint that doesn't exist, and it got a 404. So what I'm going to do is now I'm going to actually implement this endpoint. Jing. Hello, someone. And I'm actually going to inject the name here. And I'm going to say return hello. And this is going to be a get, and it's going to have a path of slash, and then the name can be input as a path parameter, and it produces text plain, and then I need the path param here. And if I save this, all my tests are great. So that's awesome. But what if I want to start doing some refactoring? Usually your REST endpoint doesn't do all the work. Usually you have some backing or business tier or whatnot. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a new class called my example service, and in here I'm going to say string get message, give it the name, return hello, right, and make this a bean, an application scope bean. And if I come back to my resource, I'm going to inject this bean, and I'm going to use constructor injection just because that's what I like to do instead of field level with the at inject annotation. And now in my endpoint, I can say return that get message name. And then when I save this, all my tests had passed, right? And it said it would rerun because of changes in the example service class. And so now if I go into my example service and I change this to hola instead of hello, it reruns just that one test because it knows only that one test was affected by the code change that I made. And so I can change this back to hello, and my test should run successfully. So what about if I wanted to externalize this a little bit? Sometimes your messages you want to externalize to like a properties file. So I could do that as well. So let me inject now some class here. Some example properties, for example. This class doesn't yet exist, so I'll have it create it, but I'm actually going to create it as an interface according to the Eclipse microprofile config specification. This will be a config mapping. The prefix will be example. And I can say string message. So now I have a property where I have example.message, right? And if I even picks up compile errors, right? Because I have a private final and I don't have a constructor, it never gets set. So now I can refactor that and I can say example properties.message plus name. I save and it failed because it says, hey, the config property example.message is required. So, okay, so I need an example.message equals hello. Save the properties file. Oh, it rerun. And it says my expected is hello space. What it actually got was hello with no space. It's because I need a space here. And now it runs again. And one last change. So instead of doing string, what if I wanted to return a JSON payload? So I would actually change my test a little bit. Instead of text, it'll be JSON. And it, instead of the body being hello, Eric, it'll have an element called message where its value is hello, Eric. And if I rerun this, it failed because it expected JSON and it got text plain, right? So if I go back to my resource now and I can change this to application JSON, and instead of a string, this needs to be some new greeting object that doesn't exist. I'll create it, and this will have a message, and I'll generate the getters and setters. I'll generate an empty constructor, or generate one that takes the message, and I'll generate an empty constructor, and then I'll wrap this in a greeting, and save, and now it ran my test, and all my tests are passed. So you can see having a test suite is really good as you start to do refactoring, and the continuous testing really understands the interactions between your code and your tests. And so as you do refactoring and even major refactoring like class name changes and all that stuff, it understands that. So thanks for watching, and I hope you enjoyed the video. Bye-bye.